Well, good morning, everyone. Perhaps I should say Merry Christmas in light of the fact that we have snow on the ground this morning. What a pleasant surprise. Brings back memories of times when we could all be together to celebrate with each other, an opportunity which unfortunately we did not have the same feel to on Easter Sunday morning. But I am glad that we are still able to carry on ministry and we're still able to connect with you. And even though it's in a virtual way, we can still continue to have fellowship with each other. I trust you had a good sleep. I apologize for yesterday morning. Something happened to my camera at that time, so I had to use my cell phone in an emergency to get this up to you. But I'm using my cell phone again this day. It seems to be a better way of getting the message out to you. So glad that you're here for daily devotions. We're in Philippians chapter 2, continuing in that passage. And specifically this morning, we're looking at verses 19 through 30. So let me pray first, and then we'll dive into this passage and read it together. Father in heaven, thank you so very, very much for this new day that you have given to us. We believe that it comes from you. It is your gift to us. We thank you for the gift of life itself, that you've given us life and breath, and you've filled our lives with good things. Your mercy is always evident to us, and we see your glory in everything that we see in your creation, and we praise you for it. And today, Lord, we just want to give you our hearts and our minds and begin this day in your word. We pray that as we look again in Paul's letter to the Philippian believers, that there will be something in this passage that will challenge us and nurture our souls. So give us the help of your spirit now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, Philippians chapter 2, and we're starting at verse 19. We're going to read here about two individuals who meant so much to the Apostle Paul, two examples to us of how we ought to be living also. Paul writes, "I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who takes a genuine interest in your welfare. For everyone looks out for his own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things go with me, and I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. But I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, who was also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. For he longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard he was ill. Indeed, he was ill and almost died, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad, and I may have less anxiety. Welcome him in the Lord with great joy, and honor men like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ, risking his life to make up for the help you could not give me." This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Well, there's a number of things here in this passage that immediately jump out. The first being, of course, these two men that Paul mentions, Timothy and Epaphroditus. But I believe that Paul makes reference to these two men here because he's still referring back to what he has said in chapter 1, that we're to live lives in a manner that is worthy of the gospel of Christ. And this whole thing that we're not supposed to live selfishly or have selfish ambition, but we're to look out for the interests of others. In other words, we're to have the mind of Jesus, the very attitude that characterized the Lord Jesus when he took the very nature of a servant. So now Paul gives us two more examples, not the Lord Jesus himself. He's already given us that example, but here's some two purely human examples, two individuals that we perhaps can relate to and understand, and they're examples of this truth. Now, Timothy was very, very special to the Apostle Paul, And if you want to follow his story through, it actually begins in Acts chapter 14, when Paul, on his first missionary journey, went to a town called Lystra, and he preached the gospel there. Later in Acts chapter 16, he goes back there, and it says that there was a disciple there named Timothy. And so Paul returns to this town, meets Timothy again, probably a second time, and Paul asked him to join his missionary team. And Timothy did, and he became the replacement for John Mark, who Paul did not want on his team any longer. So Timothy was a part of this apostolic missionary team that the Apostle Paul had. And in 2 Timothy chapter 1, we read a little bit more about him. We understand that he had a Gentile father and a Jewish mother, but it mentions his grandmother and his mother. His grandmother's name was Lois. His mother's name was Eunice. And Paul refers to the sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother, Lois, and also in your mother, Eunice. And then Paul adds, and I am now convinced lives in you also. And so in 1 Timothy chapter 1, Paul refers to him as his son in the faith. So he had a believing grandmother, he had a believing mother, and it appears that Paul had actually led him to faith in Jesus Christ. So he joins Paul's missionary team, and he had this mind of Christ. He had the same attitude that Jesus had. He had a servant heart. And in these verses, it's really clear that Paul is concerned for the church, and he loved the church at Philippi, and so he wants to send Timothy there. And in chapter 2, verse 21, 20, he says, I have no one else like him who takes a genuine interest in your welfare, for everyone looks out for his own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. So Paul's here in Rome, and he's saying, of all the people that I have with me here in Rome, none of them are like Timothy at all. They're all self-centered. They're all seeking their own ambition. They're not really concerned for the welfare of others. What an indictment on the church there. Of course, you remember we go back to chapter 1, and in chapter 1, Paul makes it clear that there were people there who were preaching with false motives. So yes, there was a church there, but the believers there were not characterized, it seems, by this servant heart. But Timothy certainly was. And so what Paul says here is about him, he says, I have no one equal to Timothy in terms of his soul, in terms of his spirit. And Timothy was a man of great devotion, because Paul makes reference to that in verse 22, that as a son with his father, he has served with me. So you can just see the affection that Paul had for this man. So a question immediately comes to my mind then is, how do you produce a person like Timothy? And I think the answer is found in verse 22. Because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. He served with the Apostle Paul. So there was something of a transaction, a transmission of the character of Paul into the character of Timothy's life. And Timothy was greatly influenced by this wonderful man who we call the Apostle Paul. In other words, Timothy got trained by him. He was discipled by him. And interestingly, in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, Paul says, Timothy, the things that you've heard from me, the things that you saw in me and heard from me, these things I want you to commit to other people, so that they will, to faithful men, so that they will be able to teach others also. So Paul wanted to transfer the gospel and gospel living into Timothy, and then to see Timothy transfer that into others. And isn't that what we're all about as a local church? You and I are to be involved in training and discipling other people, coming alongside them and helping them grow in their faith. That's exactly what the Apostle Paul did. So I think there's a real challenge here to all of us, that we too need to be involved in discipling others. Now, Paul then makes mention of this other man, Epaphroditus. Epaphroditus was not a half-Jew and a half-Gentile like Timothy was. Epaphroditus, this is clearly like a Roman name. And so he was a Gentile. Clearly, he was a member of the church at Philippi, because this passage says that the church there had sent him to the Apostle Paul. And if you go to chapter 4, verse 18, it mentions that Epaphroditus had actually brought from the church to Paul a financial gift. So this was like the missionary support of this church, and Epaphroditus was the one who delivered it to the Apostle Paul. Interestingly, his name actually means charming. So here is a charming man, and I want you to notice what's so charming about him, because he says a number of things about him. He refers to him, first of all, in verse 25 as my brother. So here's a man who clearly knew the Lord, a term of affection. He also says fellow worker. So Timothy was, Epaphroditus was really involved in the work of the Lord, and he served with the Apostle Paul. Then he uses the word soldier. And so here was a man who was fighting for the faith. He understood that the Christian life is a warfare, just as Paul tells us it is. And so he was fighting alongside the Apostle Paul in defense of the gospel of the Lord Jesus. It also says in this verse, who is also your messenger. So he wanted to communicate things to others, and he was the messenger of this church to the Apostle Paul to communicate the love that they had for Paul. Whom you sent, it says in verse 25, to take care of my needs. This man was a caregiver. In many ways, we would call him today a Stephen minister of the church. He was involved in showing care to the Apostle Paul, a caregiver. And then Paul says in verse 26, for he longs for all of you. So here was a man who loved his church. I talked to you on Easter Sunday morning about what we read in John 21 about take care of my sheep, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. And we are to love the church. And this man exemplifies this. He loved his brothers and sisters in the Lord, and he took care of God's sheep. And then Paul mentions verse 27, how ill Epaphroditus became. This was a very critical time in his life. He recovered from the illness. God had mercy on him. And Paul says to the believers there, welcome Epaphroditus in the Lord. And then verse 30, because he almost died for the work of Christ, risking his life. So here was a man who was willing to risk his life for the work of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And now there's an admonition here. I want you to notice it. It's in verse, at the last line of verse 29. It says, honor men like him. Honor men like him. Epaphroditus and Timothy too, they represent a whole category of people who the apostle says we should honor. Now, do you know people like this? Are there people like this in your life? You know, as I've been reflecting in recent days on what's happening right now and what's going on within our church family and body, I am very, very encouraged by the kinds of people that God has brought to us and are a part of the body of Christ. On April 4, Saturday morning, I had the opportunity to meet with our Deacons Council. As you know, we've just added an additional 8 deacons to that council. I think we have 28 or 29 deacons now. And as we were having this Zoom chat, and I could see all of their faces on the page in front or on the screen in front of me, I was just thrilled, because these are individuals who have dedicated their lives to serve here in our church, to meet the needs of God's people, to support the ministry of the gospel here. And these are people that we should honor. And I just had a great joy in my heart as I saw all these faces on the screen. And I just know in my heart that God has given us people like Timothy and Epaphroditus here, and we are to honor them. You may not be aware of this, but yesterday we received notice that my mother-in-law, Lorene Karam, Andrea's mom, will probably not be here on this earth very, very long. Her health is failing at this point in time. And I think of my mom-in-law, and I love her very much. And she is, to me, is one of these people that I honor, because I can remember her when she was able and younger, how she would make phone calls to people. She would visit people, but she was very, very concerned for people in the church who had struggles and health concerns. She and her husband would often invite people into their home to have a meal, people who were alone or just were having a hard time making connections within the life of the church. And she was there for them and always involved in their lives and very, very concerned for them. So there have been people like this in my own life. And I'm only mentioning just one or a few when I refer to the deacons. There have been many, many others of individuals who risked their lives, who have been brothers and soldiers and workers and caregivers, have discipled me and helped me. And that inspires me, because I need to do the same. So not only are there people like this in your life, but are you like Timothy and Epaphroditus? Are you aspiring to be like them? Are you desiring to have this same servant mindset that these two men had, because they really were imitators of the Lord Jesus Christ? Now, there are two individuals in this passage that should inspire us. But as I've been reading this, I realize there's actually three. Because Paul himself, who writes these words, is actually, all through the passage, he's expressing his desire for the believers there. And he wants to send Timothy, and he wants to send Epaphroditus to them. And the reason is he cares for them. He's not looking out for his own interests while he's in jail in Rome. He's looking out for the interests of others who are in a distant city, and he desires that they would flourish and receive all of the help that they need. So even Paul had this servant mind that we see in the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, there are all kinds of past themes in the in this letter that we see in the passage we've just read today. Because as Paul writes about Timothy and Epaphroditus, he's illustrating what partnership in the gospel looks like. These are two men who are involved in the advance of the gospel, which Paul also mentions in chapter 1. They are individuals who work with him, were working for the faith of the gospel. And clearly they were involved in the work of the gospel of Jesus, which Paul mentions here in this passage. All of these things about the work of the gospel of Christ are seen in these men. So if there's any application point that I could bring to you today, it is this. The example of Paul in discipling Timothy and forming him and shaping him into the individual that he became, a wonderful servant of the Lord. That's a challenge to you and I, that we need to be coming alongside others too and discipling them. And then the second thing is to honor those who have this kind of lifestyle and impact and leadership within God's church, to honor them, to encourage them. And I think the final thing would be, we need to aspire to be like these wonderful examples of the servant mindset of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so very, very much for people like Timothy and Epaphroditus that you have brought into our lives and that continue to influence us and impact us and inspire us to this very day. And Lord, we want to thank you for them and pray your blessing on them today. Help us to be an encouragement to them. And Father, we want to honor them. And Lord, we also want to commit ourselves to being committed disciples of Christ who come alongside others who have this servant mindset. Lord, please stir those desires within our hearts. Give to us, we pray, an answer to prayer in that we want to be your servants, to be like the Lord Jesus, to have the same mind that was in Christ. So, Lord, we pray that you will do all of this in our lives for the benefit of others and for the glory of your great name. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you for plugging in today and joining me here. I also want to remind you that next week, Pastor Jamie will be doing these daily devotion times. And the exciting thing is he's going to be doing devotions out of the Psalms. So I'm sure there's going to be a lot of rich stuff for us to soak ourselves in next week. And then also on Friday morning of this week, I will be answering any questions that you have. I've already got a few, but don't hesitate to send in more if you have them. God bless you.